वो वीडियो चला रहे हैं। Strictly reflection is a technique of slit lamp examination to see endothelial cell morphology and morphology. Bas difference ke na the illumination and the visualization arm and the opposite sides and higher magnification.
And should we start?
Yes, we can start.
Yes, ma'am.
Parallel cases from unit 3. And then what?
Yes, ma'am. Unit 3.
Okay, start.
Good afternoon, ma'am, and all the residents of RBC. I am Dr. Sai Vinith, and along with Dr. Anirudh and Dr. Priyadarshini, under the guidance of Professor Namrata, ma'am, would like to present a case on Fuchs endothelial corneal dystrophy. A 78-year-old female presented to OPD with the complaints of diminution of vision in left eye since 6 years after 2 weeks of her post-cataract surgery in the left eye, and diminution of vision in right eye since 2 years. And associated with photophobia, redness, and watery discharge in left eye. And the patient also gives history of decreased vision in the morning and improving as the day progresses in the right eye. No history of any episodes of pain or halos, and no history of any trauma to the eye. Patient is a known case of rheumatoid arthritis for 20 years and also underwent cardiac stenting for CAD in 2010. Past surgical history. Patient got operated for left eye cataract surgery 6 years ago, back in private center, following which she had only good gain of vision for 2 weeks, and later she had diminution of vision. Then she consulted our RP center, and for which she was diagnosed with left eye DMD and received intracameral injection C3F8 at our center, and followed by which she had moderate gain of vision. Later in the month, 5 months ago, she was diagnosed with both eye Fuchs endothelial corneal dystrophy with left eye corneal decompensation with pseudophakia and underwent left eye desect with very poor gain in vision. She also got operated for right eye phaco emulsification with PCAOL 4 months back, and there is good gain of vision in the right eye done at our center. Family history. No family history of similar ocular illness in her siblings or in the parental generation. And systemic examinations, vitals are within normal limits, and on further detailed systemic examination, everything seems normal. On ocular examination, best corrected visual acuity in right eye, it's 6x9, improving to 6x6 parts, and in left eye, finger counting, no further improvement with PR accurate in all quadrants. Her near vision is N6 in right eye and less than N36 in left eye. Intraocular pressure, 16 mm Hg in the right eye and digitally normal in the left eye. On refraction, plus 1.25 diopter PO with minus 1 diopter cylinder at 0 degrees and no poor streak formation in the left eye. Eyeball, lid, adnexa, and all extraocular movements are within normal limits. And in conjunctiva, there's watery discharge with diffuse congestion noted in the left eye. And coming to cornea, in right eye, the cornea seems smooth, clear with guttae present over the endothelium. And in left eye, corneal haze at all depths with more haze at the epithelial level. Subepithelial bullae are present and 360 degree superficial vascularization is seen. And desiccated lenticule, 7.5 mm diameter, attached 360 degrees. The lenticule is superiorly eccentric. Anterior chamber, deep and regular in the left eye, and one eric grade 3 and deep and clear in the right eye. Pupil, both eye reactive and circular. This is a specular reflection of right eye showing guttae in central cornea showing some guttae. And clinical picture of left eye showing 360 degrees failed graft with 360 degrees vascularization, superficial vascularization, and eccentric, superiorly eccentric lenticule, desiccated lenticule. Specular reflection is a type of illumination technique used by while doing slit lamp examination. It's based on Snell's law of optics, where angle of incidence is angle of reflection is equal to angle of incidence. In this, we align our illuminator system and to 30 degrees laterally, and observation system 30 degrees in, on the opposite side, and we prefer to have it on a low light in low intensity light. And and with maximum magnification of 25 darkness or 40 25 times or 40 times, and with this specular endothelial morphology can be detailedly noted, and any presence of guttae or any morphology of cells, endothelial cells, can be noted more detailedly. Coming to fundus lens status, both eye pseudophakic and IOL is stable. And fundus examination, right eye glow present, media hazy with cup disc ratio of 0.4:1 and NRR healthy and AV ratio of 1:3, no peripheral treatable lesions. In the left eye, the glow is present, media hazy, and disc and macular details are hazily visible. Now I would give to on further systemic investigations. CBC, LFT, RFT, and fasting blood sugar were done, ECG was done, and all the cardiac and rheumatology clearance were obtained.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Dr. Anirudh, and I will be discussing the investigation, diagnosis, management, and relevant discussion of the case. So, axial length was done for both eye, and they were right eye, it was 22.37 mm, and in the left eye was 22.33 mm. Keratometry was done and it was 47.98 in both the principal meridians in the right eye, while it wasn't captured for the left eye. Specular count in the right eye was 2248 cells per millimeter square, and it wasn't captured for the left eye. And the left eye ultrasound B scan examination was anechoic on posterior segment evaluation. So this is the serial AS OCT imaging of the patient. On the top right, we see the image when the patient first presented to us in February with the complaints of corneal decompensation post cataract surgery 6 years after her cataract surgery. Here we can see the total corneal thickness is around 900 microns, and there is an epithelial hyperplasia seen on the left side of the image. Subsequently, the patient was operated first in February, and this is the post-op week, first week image. The middle image is the post-op week 1 image after the first desec surgery. Here the corneal thickness is still raised and there is corneal edema present at all levels. The desec lenticule is well opposed, but the edema hasn't resolved. On the bottom right, we see the image when the patient presented to us second time in July. And as we can see, since February till July, the graft hasn't mildly decreased in the corneal thickness, and there is still presence of corneal edema while the lenticule is still attached. So this is a case of a primary graft failure after the first surgery. Also here we can see a subepithelial cyst or a bulla present, which depicts that the edema is present from the deep stromal level till the subepithelial level. So the differential diagnosis at this stage were Fuchs endothelial corneal dystrophy, because the patient presented us was a female in the age group of 60 to 70 with one eye under with one eye having complete corneal decompensation and presence of central guttae in the other eye. It can be pseudophakic bullous keratopathy, but other eye examination showed the presence of guttas, and so the primary diagnosis was more in favorable of Fuchs endothelial corneal dystrophy. One other differential diagnosis is posterior polymorphous corneal dystrophy, but in these cases they might have gutta but also have endothelial vesicles and ridges, which was absent in our case. And one more diagnosis can be ICE syndrome, specifically Chandler's syndrome, but these cases are acquired and present at a younger adult age group and are unilateral. And last differential can be Hassel-Henle bodies, but again these are age-related degenerative changes of the endothelium, which do not involve the central cornea and are rarely associated with corneal edema as seen in our case. So this is the preoperative clinical picture of the right eye and the left eye. The right eye, we can see the cornea appears clear, but on specular reflection as shown by Dr. Saivani, there were presence of gutta in the central cornea, while in the left eye, again, there is complete corneal edema and corneal haze with 360 degree superficial vascularization and a failed desec lenticule visible. So the definitive diagnosis was both eye Fuchs endothelial corneal dystrophy with right eye stage 1 FECD with pseudophakia and with left eye operated desec with failed graft with pseudophakia. And the patient was planned for a left eye repeat desec under cardiac monitoring. Few slides about Fuchs endothelial corneal dystrophy. It is a bilateral disease, slowly progressive, asymmetric corneal disease. It can be sporadic, and if it is inherited, it is most commonly inherited in an autosomal dominant fashion with variable expressivity and incomplete penetrance. The most common mutation associated with Fuchs dystrophy is SLC4A11, which is an ion channel molecule present at the endothelium level and is responsible for the endothelial pump. So if this ion channel molecule is defective, there is the pump is not able to pump water out of the cornea, that leads to corneal edema and progressive corneal decompensation. It is more commonly seen in females than males, and there is deterioration of the endothelial cells morphology as well as function with subsequent development of guttae, which has basically excrescences of the desprit membrane. So clinical features, these patients usually present in the 6th and the 7th decade and initially have painless blurry vision associated with glare sometimes, and often they have worse vision in the morning as overnight the eyelid is closed and there is decreased evaporative drying of the cornea, leading to worse vision in the morning. As these kind of complaints were present in the right eye of our patient. Subsequently, as the edema progresses and involves all layers of the stroma and goes to the subepithelial level, there is formation of painful bullae, and these bullae stretch the subepithelial, like irritate the subepithelial plexus of nerve, and therefore the patient now has pain. And these often rupture, leading to subepithelial scarring. The slit lamp examination, we have to see the corneal edema, corneal haze, presence of guttae, presence of subepithelial bullae, scarring, and presence of superficial vascularization at the later stages. And relevant investigations are central corneal thickness, specular microscopy, confocal microscopy to see the endothelial health, and anterior segment OCT to measure the corneal thickness as well as the level of involvement of the corneal edema. So staging of Fuchs endothelial corneal dystrophy has been described on the basis of the severity. In stage 1, the patients are essentially asymptomatic, and they are often diagnosed incidentally by the presence of central corneal guttae, which are usually non-confluent. As the patient progresses to stage 2, the guttae collase become larger and the patient develops central corneal edema and often have symptoms of painless blurry vision, worse in the morning. In stage 3, the edema progresses all throughout the stromal layer and reaches the subepithelial level, and there is formation of subepithelial bullae, and subsequently the patient also experiences pain. So now the patient has painful blurring of vision. And subsequently in stage 4, these subepithelial bullae rupture, leading to subepithelial scarring and also associated vascularization of the cornea. So the patient was planned for a repeat desec surgery. I'll be showing you the surgery briefly. So initially, epithelium was removed from the host cornea to epithelial debridement was done of the host cornea to improve the visualization. Since there was superficial vascularization, there was a lot of bleeding present during the process of epithelial removal, and this bleeding was subsequently controlled using Edrisop swab sticks. Now, prior to proceeding with the host cornea, first in D6 surgeries, we have to prepare the donor lenticule. So the a B plus grade tissue was used, and it was mounted on the artificial corneal chamber, and the epithelium of the donor cornea was scraped off, and the corneal thickness was measured, which in our case was around 560 microns. After the measurement of the epithelial total corneal thickness, appropriate size head of the microkeratome was subsequently mounted. We used a 450 micron microkeratome head and used a Moria microkeratome to dissect the donor lenticule. A single pass technique was used, and after the dissection of the donor lenticule, the remaining thickness of the dissect lenticule in our case was around 62 microns. Subsequently, using a 7.5 mm handheld disposable trephine, the central part of the donor lenticule was trephined. And the remaining corneosclerel rim was removed. The donor lenticule was wet using the cornisol solution. And now a localized peritomy was done and the bleeders were cauterized. A 3.5 mm incision was made on the sclera, and using a crescent blade, a corneosclerel tunnel was created. Two MVR entries were made. The first entry was used to install an AC maintainer so that the AC remains deep during the surgery, and using a reverse Sinsky hook, the previous graft was scored using the second MVR site, 360 degrees, similar to a desmatorexis, which is performed in a primary dissect surgery, and the old failed graft was then scraped off and subsequently detached from the host cornea. A full thickness incision was now created using a 3.2 blade, and around a 3.5 mm incision was created. The old graft tissue was removed and was spread over the host cornea to check for its entirety, that it's a complete circle and no remaining part of the old graft is retained in the host cornea. Now, using gentle manipulation, the donor lenticule was loaded on a Bucin's glide with endothelial side up and was pulled into the funnel shaped part of the Bucin glide using a forceps. The Bucin glide was inverted and inserted on the main incision, and using a pull through technique, the dissect lenticule was pulled inside the AC through the opposite MVR entry using a forceps. As soon as the graft was in place, the flow of the AC chamber maintainer was increased so that the graft unfolds. And as we can see on the ASOCT, the graft is now well unfolded and air bubble was injected through the main site. Using gentle tapping movements, the graft was now centered, and subsequently by the help of an IOCT, we can see that the graft is well opposed to the host cornea all throughout, and the graft is well centered. Now the peritomy was closed. So post-operatively, the patient was advised strict supine position to ensure opposition of the graft host graft and the host cornea, and pad and bandage was opened next morning. The patient was started on eye drop moxifloxacin 3 times and steroids 2 hourly for initial 3 days, followed by tapering to 6 times a day. Also, topical hypertonic saline was used to aid in the detergence of the host cornea, and topical eye drop Repatec was used as an anti-glaucoma medication with the other drops. And the post-operative status on day 1, this patient was still hand movement vision, but the graft was well opposed and due to the presence of corneal edema, the vision didn't improve. But as early as post-op day 7, the vision improved to 2/60. The graft was well centered and well opposed, and there was still presence of residual stromal edema. And finally, at post-op day 21, the uncorrected visual acuity of the patient was 6/60, and the graft had the host cornea had cleared a lot since the pre-op. So this is the post-op day 7. We can see the graft is well opposed, but still there is presence of corneal edema in the host cornea, as well as presence of subepithelial microcystic cavities. On post-op day 10, there is slight improvement in the clarity, while on post-op day 21, there is a marked improvement in the corneal clarity, and the patient had an uncorrected visual of 6/60. Also, at post-op day 21, the AS-OCT showed a decrease in the central corneal thickness from 900 micron preoperatively to 600 micron now, and with decrease in the corneal haze. A brief discussion about posterior lamellar keratoplasty. So posterior lamellar keratoplasty is selective replacement of the posterior layers of the cornea, which are essentially the endothelium and the desmids. The one prerequisite is that the host cornea should not have a corneal scarring involving the stroma. If that is the case, a PK is preferred over an EK. So initially, the first described technique was a DELIC, in which a posterior stromal pocket was made, and the host cornea, posterior stroma, desmids and endothelium was trephined using that deep stromal pocket, and a similar donor tissue was inserted through that pocket. Since then, the technique of DSEK came, and similar technique of DSAEK came. So in automated endothelial keratoplasty, we use a microkeratome to dissect the donor cornea. In these cases, as shown in the surgery, the donor lenticule is compromised of a thin layer of the posterior stroma, desmids, and an endothelium. While DMEC is a more advanced surgery where we only selectively replace the host endothelium and a desmid membrane. A recent surgery also been described as a PDEC surgery, which is a pre-desmatic endothelial keratoplasty described by Dr. Amar Agarwal in 2016. And in this, there is selective replacement of the endothelium, desmids, and the overlying Duwa's layer. So indications for EK can be classified into endothelial dystrophy, like in our case Fuchs endothelial dystrophy and other endothelial dystrophies, just as PPCD and CHEDs, also in ICE syndrome. It can be in post-cataract surgery corneal decompensation, such as pseudophakic bullous keratopathy and aphakic bullous keratopathy, and endothelial decompensation after vitrectomy surgery and after glaucoma filtering surgeries. It can also be in post-traumatic endothelial decompensation. Other indications can be a failed PK or a failed DSEC. Failed DSEC was the case in our case. And post-recurrent herpetic endothelitis, which can lead to endothelial compromise. Also, desmid breaks due to birth trauma injury due to forceps delivery can be an indication. And in other cases such as aniridia and buphthalmos, where there is associated endothelial compromise, a DSEC surgery can be done. A brief discussion about the two most popular DSEC endothelial keratoplasty surgery. So DMEC surgery, being more physiological, has a rapid physiological recovery, and a better, more percentage of the patient develop a better visual acuity. Since there is no stromal interface, there is no problem of interface haze in DMEC, and the related hyperopic shift is also minimal in the case of a DMEC, while it's around 1 micron to 1.5 micron in DSEC. The graft rejection rates are higher in a DSEC surgery, as we are inserting a donor tissue having more amount of foreign antigen. Also, the rate of pass formation is higher with DSEC, but the chances of graft dislocation are more with DMEC, as the tissue is more pliable and fragile. Endothelial cell loss associated with surgeries have varying reported incidences. In general, DMEC surgery has a higher endothelial cell loss, but a recent study showed that especially in cases of Fuchs endothelial dystrophy, the rate of endothelial cell loss was comparable at the end of 1 year. The learning curve is more difficult for a DMEC surgery, and for a DSEC surgery, we need a microkeratome to dissect the donor lenticule. Also, the anterior lamella can be subsequently used for a DALC, so one tissue can be used for two patients. Also, there is a less stringent age criteria for DSEC surgery, while in DMEC surgery, we prefer graft of age more than 40 to 50 years, as in young patients, their tissue is very elastic and leads to surgical difficulties. So, complications related with endothelial keratoplasty in the immediate phase can be graft dislocation, pupillary block glaucoma due to the air we inject in the anterior chamber, primary graft failure, and associated inflammation and infection due to surgery. In the late phase, it can be a secondary graft failure, a graft rejection, a secondary infection, and secondary glaucoma. So this is a picture showing on the left side an endothelial graft rejection. So specifically in endothelial keratoplasty, patient usually do not present with the characteristic Hodgdon's line, which is seen in post-PK endothelial rejection. These patients often have a subtle sign such as like the corneal edema comes back, there are folds in the desmoid membrane, and there might be few scattered KPs. So we need to be extra careful with the follow-up of post-EK patients and ensure serial CCT and endothelial microscopy to ensure that the graft is functioning well. Also, the DSEC and the DMEC lenticule can dislocate post-surgery, and injection, an intracameral injection of an air or long-standing gas is very helpful in such cases. In our case, we prefer doing an ultra-thin DSEC, the surgical results of ultra-thin DSEC have been shown to be very comparable to a DMEC surgery. So ultra-thin DSEC surgeries are defined when the donor lenticule thickness is less than 110 to 100 microns. Now, Dr. Priyadarshini will be carrying out with the further case summary and discussion.
Very good afternoon to one and all present here. So to summarize our case, there was this 78-year-old female who presented to us with diminution of vision in the left eye for the past 6 years, along with watering redness and photophobia in the left eye. And initially she had undergone a cataract surgery 6 years back, after which there was reduction in her visual acuity after 2 weeks. And then there was she presented to RPC, and DMD was noted, for which C3F8 injection was given intracamerally. And after that, in February 2021, 5 months back, a left eye DSEC surgery was performed for the corneal decompensation. And on further follow-up, the primary DSEC surgery was found to be the primary DSEC graft had undergone a primary rejection and had gone, and the patient had to be planned for a second repeat DSEC surgery in the left eye. So coming to the incidence and risk factors of endothelial failure after phacoemulsification in patients with Fuchs endothelial corneal dystrophy was studied by Dai et al. And he found that in a cohort of 2,873 patients who underwent phacoemulsification with intraocular lens implantation, that the coexisting intraoperative complications was an important risk factor for developing a postoperative corneal endothelial failure in patients with Fuchs endothelial corneal dystrophy. So intraoperative complications in a cataract surgery in a patient with Fuchs endothelial corneal dystrophy play an important role in further decompensation. So what are the risk factors for endothelial failure in a patient of Fuchs endothelial corneal dystrophy? So when the patient comes to OPD, before planning any cataract surgery, we need to assess the cornea from the epithelium to endothelium carefully, look for any scarring, any signs of heel keratitis. When we come into the endothelium, we need to look at the endothelial cell count. If we are suspicious of any guttae centrally or any dropouts in the endothelial cells. So when we look at the specular count, if we find that the specular count is less than 1000 per millimeter square, or if the central corneal thickness is greater than 640 microns in a suspected case of Fuchs endothelial corneal dystrophy, it is better to defer the cataract surgery and rather plan a combined keratoplasty along with cataract surgery. So these are the guidelines, these are the two cutoffs according to the AGO guidelines, current AGO guidelines. And intraoperatively, if these cutoff values are satisfied, if we go ahead with a cataract surgery, we need to, currently we do not use a longitudinal phacoemulsification probe, we use a torsional one, but in conventional longitudinal phaco probes, where it is used even today in some remote areas, it can lead to a higher endothelial cell loss. And if the CDE in the phaco settings, if the energy used is goes above 20, then there is a higher risk of endothelial cell loss. And also the intraoperative complications such as Descemet's membrane detachment, iris incarceration intraoperatively in the wound, and intraoperative corneal edema increases the risk of endothelial cell loss in Fuchs patients. And the Descemet's and Fuchs patients is also more prone to detachment. So we need to be very careful during the surgery in a Fuchs patient intraoperatively.
Discussing all the studies?
No, ma'am, just the important points of the studies.
Okay, no, because you've already given the points. No point, if you have any extra point, then maybe you can discuss, otherwise move on to the next, because we have another presentation and their time has also come.
In a cataract surgery, in a Fuchs patient, we would prefer a smaller capsular rexus, and we would prefer a phaco-chop technique wherein the endothelial cell loss is lesser, and a soft shell technique can be used wherein we use a viscodispersive to coat over the endothelium and then push in a viscocohesive agent into the AC to protect the endothelium. And monofocal IOLs are preferred over any other multifocal IOL in a Fuchs patient to avoid further glare. And so in case of a graft failure in DSIC, we need to monitor the endothelial cell count and the graft thickness constantly. So if there is initial low marginal endothelial cell count in the initial graft, the graft is likely to go in for an endothelial decompensation, like what happened in our case. And the other case can be there was initially a good endothelial cell count in the graft, and later on there was an episode of rejection which happened either because of tapering of steroids or because of the host and donor factors. So later on the graft develops a stromal edema, so these patients need to be followed up carefully and the steroid tapering has to be done carefully. So the main risk factors for graft rejection in a case of DSIC is pre-existing glaucoma, any steroid response of ocular hypertension, and African Americans are also more prone for graft rejection in comparison to Caucasians. However, even if there was a DSIC done in the other eye within the last 1 year, that is not an important factor in graft rejection. So finally, the take-home message from our case is that in a case of Fuchs and in any case of corneal decompensation post-cataract surgery, the other eye should be looked at carefully to rule out Fuchs for further planning of the cataract surgery in the other eye as well. And preoperative endothelial cell count and CCT assessment before planning any cataract surgery is very important. And an efficient phacoemulsification, minimizing the chances of complication, can do a lot of good in a case of Fuchs endothelial corneal dystrophy and postpone the need for any endothelial keratoplasty, like what happened in the right eye of our case. And in the follow-up, serial endothelial cell count and ASOCT for monitoring CCT is very important to pick up the graft rejection early on and treat it. Thank you.
So I think you covered quite well, Priyadarshini. Are there any questions for us? So Priyadarshini, what is the question? There is a question, I think, there.
No question.
So I think we can move to the next question. Okay. Dr. Tanush is there?
Sir will be joining.
Okay, we can start presenting the next piece.
Good afternoon, everyone. Today I'll be presenting a case presentation of a patient visited RPC 3 weeks ago. The patient was a 52-year-old male working in border security forces. He belongs to Murad Nagar, Ghaziabad, UP. patient first experienced blurring of vision 6 years ago in September 2015 and consulted in RPC in October 2015. He was diagnosed to be a case of glaucoma and was started on topical medications. He primarily achieved optimal IOP, but patient was admitted in July because of incompetence to medications and for delayed IOP levels and was managed medically. He was again admitted in February 2018 and was managed medically. Patient was admitted again in February 2019 for right eye augmented trabeculectomy surgery and achieved relief in the right eye. Then patient lost follow-up in 2020 due to COVID and lockdown restrictions. Patient followed up again in June 2021 with elevated pressures in the left eye and optimal pressures in the right eye and non-compliance to medications for past 6 months. So patient was planned for an augmented trabeculectomy surgery in left eye. This was the charting of patient IOP with medications. He was diagnosed in October 2015 and then admitted in 2016 with elevated pressures and was managed medically. Then again in February 2018. Then patient was admitted here for right eye augmented trabeculectomy and for IOP was achieved after the surgery. Then patient visited us in June 2021 with these non-compliance to medications in left eye and was admitted on 5th of August. There is no known history of any systemic disease. Patient had right trabeculectomy surgery, as I told previously. No history of any known drug or food allergy. No history of any ocular head injury and no history of any medication use. No history of any family glaucoma. Patient belongs to an active lifestyle and occasional alcohol intake is there. No history of smoking and any substance abuse. On examination, we found out that the patient's best corrective vision in the right eye is 6x12 and in the left eye 6x18. Near vision, it was N12 and N18. And IOP on non-contact tonometry was 13 in the right eye and 11 in the left eye. On applanation, 12 in both eyes, while on oral and topical medications for left eye. On pupil examination, patient was noted to have anisocoria, 2 mm in the right eye and 4 mm in the left eye. On slit lamp examination, patient was found to have pigments on the corneal endothelium. On slit lamp examination, pigments on the corneal endothelium were seen in both eyes. One had a grade 3 on both eyes with no cells. Early MSC was noted in both eyes. And patient on gonioscopy examination, this is the gonioscopy examination of the right eye. Patient, this is the superior angle. The patient's ostium is intact of the right eye augmented trabeculectomy. We can see there is heavy pigmentation on the Schlemm's canal and trabecular meshwork. In the left eye gonioscopy pictures, we can see the pigmentation as well. And on the fundus examination, we can see near total cupping of both eyes of the patient, evident with the findings noted in the Humphrey visual fields on a 10-2 side, where the center and temporal fields are the only remaining with biarcuate scotoma in the both eyes. This is a patient was managed with the left eye augmented trabeculectomy. This is a surgery video. First, corneal traction sutures was passed. Then, for limbal base peritomy was done. Then, the vessels were cauterized. Partial thickness scleral flap was made. First, the mitomycin C was soaked swabs were inserted, then partial thickness scleral flap was made. It was extended using a crescent. Then MVR entry was made in AC was formed with air bubble was inserted. Then partial thickness flap was extended till AC and iris peripheral iridectomy was done. After that, flap was closing using 10-0 MFN sutures. AC was formed and checked. Air bubble was intact. Peritomy was closed using 8-0 Weichel. On On post-operative period, patient was started on topical medications, including a combination of getifloxacin and prednisolone, and another combination of chloramphenicol, polymyxin B, and dexamethasone and tropicamide drops. Here we can see a mildly elevated bleb, which is microcystic in appearance, and air bubble is intact, which shows healthy bleb, and the patient IOP was relieved. It was 5 in the post-operative period. Now Dr. Anand will be discussing the presentation, and the case was case diagnosis. Thank you.
Good evening, one and all. I am carrying forward the today's discussion on pigment dispersion syndrome and pigmentary glaucoma. So, Bharat already discussed the case scenario, which is managed with augmented trabeculectomy in left eye. So, coming to the discussion, basically the terminology refers to on seeing slit lamp examination, there is pigmented cells on the corneal endothelium. On iris examination, there is transillumination defects in mid-peripheral iris of almost PDS patients. There is on gonioscopy increased pigmentation of the trabecular meshwork. Here we can see there is a vertical stripe of pigmentation on the corneal endothelium. Here on gonioscopy, this is inferior angle seeing in superior mirror of the Goldman 3 mirror gonioscope. There is dense homogeneous pigmentation on the posterior trabecular meshwork, which is there is slightly pigmented line, we can see Solvay's line. This is a wide open angle where there is scleral spur, we can see. And coming to demographic, these pigment dispersion syndrome patients are mostly of young, having age range of 30 to 50 years with myopic. Mostly pigment dispersion syndrome we can see in Caucasians, more pigmentary glaucoma more prevalent in men of 78% to 93%, but pigment dispersion syndrome most commonly seen in female patients. Coming to terminology, pigment dispersion syndrome, which is ocular condition where dispersion of the iris pigments throughout the eye we can see, which is commonly associated with pigmentary ocular hypertension and pigmentary glaucoma. Pigment dispersion syndrome, which is usually bilateral. So coming to pigmentary ocular hypertension, where pigment dispersion syndrome with elevated IOP, no glaucomatous optic neuropathy signs. In pigmentary glaucoma, there is pigment dispersion syndrome with features of glaucoma like IOP elevation, glaucomatous optic neuropathy, visual field defects we can elevate. Coming to the theories behind pigment dispersion syndrome, one is abiotrophic theory, which is proposed by Shi and Fischer. There is inherent property of weakness and degeneration in the iris pigment epithelial cells. So because of this inherent property, there is changes in the iris pigment epithelium as focal atrophy, hyperpigmentation, apparent delay in melanogenesis, hyperplasia of the dilator muscle are there, then hypervascular iris we can see. So the second theory is mechanical aberration theory by Campbell, where there is because of the posteriorly inserted and posterior bubbing of the iris, peripheral iris, there is mechanical rubbing between lens junules and iris posterior iris pigment epithelial cells. Because of these rubbing, the pigment epithelial release is there and dispersion into the anterior chamber is there. These pigments gets accumulated in the trabecular meshwork, gets obstruction to the outflow facility. So one proposed mainly thing is reverse pupillary block, where because of the blinking and accommodative effects or sternness exercises, so there is movement of the aqueous from the posterior chamber to anterior chamber as a flap valve mechanism, means unidirectional flow of the aqueous. Once aqueous flows from anterior posterior chamber to anterior chamber, then once these pigments gets accumulated in the trabecular meshwork, so one in the anterior chamber IOP builds up more and more, and there is no backward flow of the aqueous from the anterior chamber to posterior chamber. So this accumulated aqueous in the anterior chamber pushes the mid peripheral iris backwards, and reverse pupillary block happens. coming to mechanisms behind elevation of IOP in pigment dispersion syndrome or pigmentary glaucoma, these released pigments because of the frequent rubbing between zonules and mid peripheral iris, the pigment release gets accumulated in the trabecular meshwork endothelial cells. These endothelial cells gets phagocytic and phagocyte the pigments and gets overloaded and leads to their death. So after death, these necrotic cells and together pigments gets cleared by the macrophages. These loss of trabecular cells gets collapsed, and these collapsed trabecular meshwork leads to obliteration of the outflow channels. Because of the obliteration of the outflow channels, there is elevation of building up of pressure in the eye. So coming to clinical features, most of the pigment dispersion syndrome patients are asymptomatic. So after developing glaucoma, they frequently present with headaches and episodes of blurring of vision, particularly after strenuous exercises or physical exercise. So once glaucoma develops, they will complain of halos around a pine source of light because of frequent pigment release, which is called as pigment shower, and IOP gets elevated and corneal edema happens. Coming to signs, most of these pigmentary glaucoma patients present with IOPs of more than 31 mm of Hg, which is normally, compared to POAG patients, is much greater than that. So, 12.5% of patients present with IOP of more than 39 mm of Hg. So, a 25-year review done by Sugar at Italy, then he showed that there is a range of IOP where pigmentary glaucoma patients present is almost 24 to 56 mm of Hg. So coming to on slit lamp examination, corneal findings, so you can see there is vertical strip of pigmentation on the corneal endothelium. This is called as Krukenberg spindle, which is more commonly seen in women. Maybe there is some research evidence shows that hormonal influence mainly affects that, more commonly seen in women. So on specular microscopy, you can see polymegadism and pleomorphism, but specular count and CCT are normal in range. Coming to gonioscopic findings, here we can see these are the wide open angles. Here we can see this is the swell baseline, which is more anteriorly placed, and the pigmentation just anterior to the swell baseline. This is the anterior trabecular meshwork, which is non-pigmented, and there is a dense homogeneous pigmentation of the posterior trabecular meshwork, and this whitish width zone is scleral spur and ciliary body band, we can see. So this is mostly, all these patients are open angle patients with dense homogeneous accumulation of pigment in the posterior trabecular meshwork. Here this is the superior angle of inferior gonioscopic mirror, showing that dense homogeneous pigmentation, and the red arrow shows that swell baseline apparent. So on gonioscopy, we can see there is backward bowing of the iris also. So basically, this backward bowing mostly because of the congenitally more posterior iris insertion. And sometimes on gonioscopy, we can see more number of iris processes anterior to scleral spur. Coming to iris findings, there is mid-peripheral trans-illumination defects, which also called as church window defects, which is most commonly of about 86% of the PDS patients in light colored iris we can see. Compared to pseudo exfoliation syndrome, where these transillumination defects are peripupillary, means just adjacent to the pupil, but in these pseudo exfoliation syndromes are peripupillary, but on contrary to that, so pigment dispersion syndrome is mid periphery. So heterochromia, anisochoria, we can see in asymmetric eyes, mimic Horner syndrome, mainly because of hyperplastic dilator muscles and with loss of pigments, we can see. So there is delay in iris melanogenesis, we can see, and on angiography, we can see there is vascular hyperperfusion and iris hypoplasia and angiography. Coming to anterior chamber findings, these patients are mostly having deeper anterior chambers than POAG patient. So male pigment dispersion syndromes patients having higher AC depth than female pigment dispersion syndrome. So one gentmian line is the one line where pigment deposition on the anterior capsule of the lens. Other is sheer strips where there is pigment accumulation at the junction of the posterior lens capsule and the zonules. One more thing is Yeager's line, where the deposition of pigments on the anterior hyaldocapsular ligament. Then these after glaucoma surgeries, the filtrating blebs also show there is inferior accumulation of the pigments in the bleb in pigment dispersion syndrome and pigmentary glaucoma patients. Coming to finding fundus findings, because all these patients are myopic and young, they have peripheral retinal degenerative changes as lattice degeneration. In PDS patients, we can mostly around 20 to 33% of the PDS patients show lattice degeneration, which is higher than myopes. And there is chances of retinal detachment in these myopic patients of 5.5 to 6.5%. Which is also again higher than myopes, and about 12% of PDS patients present with retinal break. So always keep in mind, whenever in OPD the pigment dispersion syndrome patients comes, make sure that peripheral retina is examined and well diagnosed. Coming to one provocative mydriatic test with phenylephrine. So once you dilate the PDS patient with phenylephrine, there is release of 10 or more pigment particles with or without acute rise in IOP. Then the patient can be told as acute phase of pigment dispersion. The patient is in acute phase of pigment dispersion, means he is in high risk for progression. So always treat with pilocarpine and make sure there is pigment liberation has to be reduced, and start on to 1 or 2 anti-glaucoma medications according to the titration of IOP. So once after dilation, the dilator pupilla contacts the pigment epithelial cells of the iris, posterior pigment epithelial cells of the iris, which ruptures and gets flowed through the aqueous currents into the anterior chamber. So basically this test identifies that patients with active disease and who are higher risk for progression. So this test got no absolute predictive value. So just for diagnosis and to know the which patients are at higher risk and which patients having active disease. Coming to differential diagnosis, mostly pigment dispersion syndrome patients gets confused with pseudo exfoliation syndrome, where these transillumination defects are peripupillary, and on gonioscopy there is patchy trabecular meshwork pigmentation in pseudo-exfoliation. But on pigment dispersion syndrome, there is a dense homogeneous pigmentation of the posterior trabecular meshwork we can see. Apart from that, secondly, we can get confused with anterior uveitis, because in uveitis also there is acute iris pigment epitheliitis we can see with release of pigments into the AC. One more thing, these transillumination defects are most commonly seen in herpetic uveitis with elevated IOP. So always look for viral causes whenever the patient presents with uveitis or pigment dispersion syndrome. So post-traumatic or intraocular surgeries also we get confused. So always take proper history, any surgical intervention has been taken or any history of trauma. So because of these things, the pigment release into the aqueous and there is transillumination defects, although because of iatrogenic causes of the surgery like, and increased trabecular meshwork pigmentation. Other thing, intraocular tumors, which are most commonly anterior uveal melanomas, which releases pigments and from that tumor cells into the AC, and there is IOP elevation. So mostly intraocular tumors we have to suspect in unilateral cases or asymmetric cupping, asymmetric IOP elevations. So we have to look for intraocular tumors. So mostly PDS patients are bilateral, but intraocular tumors we have to look for unilateral or asymmetric cases. With increasing age also, there is accommodation power loss is there, and because of these things, increased lens axial length. So there is increased iris pigment epithelial release with the age. In rhegmatoid unit's retinal detachment also, there is pigment released into the vitreous or into the AC. We have to look for any breaks and retinal detachment. On long-term mydriasis or frequent mydriasis also, there is pigment release. And mostly diabetic patients also present with transillumination defect. We have to keep in mind whenever see all these DDs and look for causes to diagnose pigment dispersion or some other based on these positive findings. Coming to risk factors, where PDS patients which convert into pigmentary glaucoma. So most of the 26 to 48% of the patients who present with pigmentary glaucoma are showing family history of glaucoma is there. And male sex is the one risk factor for predisposition to progression of pigmentary glaucoma. And all these PDS and pigmentary glaucoma patients are almost myopes. And presence of Krukenberg spindle is one of the risk factors where we have to look for progression and pigment release in acute stages. Once pigment dispersion syndrome with IOP of more than 21 mm of HG, definitely we have to look for progression and control gets control the IOP. Then if you are doing frequent pupillary dilatation, so always look for pigment release or things. Then some research evidence shows that in normal and POAG patients, once you do the exercise, there is reduced in IOP because of increased outflow facility, because on exercise in cells there is increased blood lactate levels which decreases the pH, and because of the hemodynamic changes there is increase in outflow facility. But in PDS patients, because of exercise there is increased pigment release, and because of these pigment release, these pigments get accumulated in the trabecular meshwork and the outflow facility is dampened and IOP rise is seen. Other things are accommodation and blinking. Mainly blinking causes unidirectional flow of the aqueous from the posterior chamber to anterior chamber, and because of the reduced accommodation power, so there is relaxation of the zonules, and these zonules get rubbed against the posterior surface of the iris pigment epithelial cells and pigment release gets increased. One more thing is burnout stage of pigmentary glaucoma, where initially there is pigment release is much more and IOP elevation is there. On successive stages, on advanced stage, there is progressive decline in IOP and progressive decline in levels of pigment release. And the pigment release is decreased, then the inferior angle mostly relieve of pigmentation and gets accumulated in the superior angle. That is called pigment reversal sign. Actually, because of the pigment gravity, the inferior angle first gets dense pigmentation, then followed by in advanced stage superior angle. That is called pigment reversal. Then leads to normalization of IOP. Because of the in advanced stages, once pigment release decreased and there is normalization of IOP, so we have to look. We will get confused with POAG because of low levels of IOP or normal tension glaucomas. So always look for pigmentation or any signs of pigment dispersion syndrome to make sure that correct diagnosis is there. So don't confuse with POAG and normal tension glaucoma with pigment dispersion syndrome. So proposed mechanisms behind these burnout stages, mainly because of increased age, there is reduced accommodative power, which age related meiosis is there, and age related increased lens axial length. So these are the proposed mechanisms for burnout stage. Coming to clinical course, how the PDS patient convert into pigmentary glaucoma. So once PDS patient diagnosed, they will take several years to develop pigmentary glaucoma. And almost the conversion rate from PDS to pigmentary glaucoma is 10% at 5 years and 15% at 15 years. So burnout stage increases with when patient on progressively increases the age. Coming to diagnostic testings, so once for diagnosing the glaucoma or progression, we have to look for assessment of the optic nerve and iris configurations and biometric indices. Coming to assessment of the optic nerve, we have to look for structural assessment and functional assessment. Structurally, we can look for RNFL changes, functionally visual field changes or progression. Then coming to RNFL thickness, so mostly pigmentary glaucoma patients having less RNFL thickness than pigment dispersion syndrome than normal control patients. Then coming to there is loss of superior and inferior ganglionic cell complex in the pigmentary glaucoma than PDS patient. On visual field examination, this is the same patient of as earlier Bharat Arora has been presented. This is the patient named Ibrahimuddin, who is 54 year old and having refractive error of 2.5 diopter spherical. This is a 10-2 Sita standard Humphreys visual field of showing pupillary diameter of 6.4 mm. All the demographic data is reliable, and the these visual fields are reliable tests, and showing there is biarcuate scotoma or double arcuate scotoma on 10-2 field, only remnant of central and temporal fields in both eyes. So already right eye is already operated 1 month before of admission and having IOP of around 10 and 12 mm of HG, where other eye which we posted for surgery. So mainly over the 10 years of follow up, almost half of the patient, means 50% of the patients show progression on visual fields. Mainly the progression mainly because of the inter-visit IOP fluctuations and IOP elevations. Coming to iris configuration, mainly ultrasound biomicroscopy and gonioscopy confirm that mid-peripheral iris concavity is there. So mainly because of this concavity, there are some inherent properties of the iris insertion or some mesodermal distances during development. So these things, there is rubbing of the iris jonules with the posterior surface of the iris. So the release of pigments are there, and the pigment accumulation in the anterior chamber happens. So once laser peripheral iridotomy we will do in the periphery area, so there is relief of this concavity and iris gets flattened. So UBM and gonioscopy helps in identifying these patients. Coming to biometric indices, mainly anterior recipient OCT help in demonstrating iridolenticular contact and anterior chamber volume and anterior chamber angles, whether these are closed or open, any inflammatory membranes, and trabecular meshwork status we can see on ASOCT. Coming to stages of pigmentary glaucoma and pigment dispersion syndrome. So first stage, actually the patient, once patient presents to it with pigmentation and all these signs, so you have to look for the patient in PDS or pigmentary glaucoma. So for PDS, the patient's having inactive pigment dispersion and there is normal IOP with no glaucomatous changes, as glaucomatous optic neuropathy or visual field changes. Coming to second stage, there is pigment liberation is there, means active pigment dispersion with stable IOP, no glaucomatous changes. In stage 3, which is developed into pigmentary glaucoma, where active pigment liberation with elevated IOP you can see, where there is progressive glaucomatous optic neuropathy or glaucomatous visual field changes. In stage 4, as earlier I have explained, that burnout stage, which is fourth stage, there where there is pigment liberation is reduced and there is normal or elevated IOP, but the glaucomatous optic neuropathy and glaucomatous visual field changes are progressive. Coming to management, only one drug which helps in pigment dispersion or pigmentary glaucoma is pilocarpine, mainly based on two mechanism of actions. One is pupillary constriction and reduces the iridojonular friction or contact, which is the main baseline cause of pigment release. Other thing, once we put on pilocarpine medication, it acts on the anterior fibers of the ciliary muscle, gets contracted, and there is opening of the trabecular meshwork spaces and increases the outflow facility. These are the two proposed mechanisms for pilocarpine in pigment dispersion syndrome or pigmentary glaucoma patients. So there are disadvantages also, where these patients are young and myopic, so they are very poorly tolerated to pilocarpine. Other thing, there is because of pilocarpine, there is because of stress and relaxation of the zonules and anteriorly movement of the ciliary body and lens complex, there is stretching of the vitreous body also, so there is risk of retinal detachment. Coming to the anti-glaucoma ocular hypertensive medications, so first line comes under prostaglandin analogs, where they increase the uveous clear outflow. So trabecular meshwork is already damaged and obstructed with the much more pigmentation, so prostaglandin comes as first line. Other thing is the second line is aqueous suppressants as alpha 2 agonists or beta blockers or carbonic anhydrase inhibitors. So coming to laser therapy, is most commonly successful in pigment dispersion or pigmentary glaucomas, mainly because there is dense pigmentation which is heavily dense, the laser energy get easily absorbed and there is opening of the subadjacent trabecular spaces. But these lasers, trabeculoplasty, last for some shorter duration, for about 6 months to 1 year. After that, again, there is spikes in IOP rise and again glaucoma progression we can see. So only mainly in progression of glaucoma, you have to go for incisional surgeries. Other thing is laser peripheral iridotomy. Once there is, if you do laser peripheral iridotomy, there is equalization of pressure between anterior and posterior chambers and the concavity of the iris is get reduced. Means flattening of the iris we can see and relieving of the pupillary block, and there is reduction of the iridozonular contact and reduction of the pigment liberation. So insufficient evidence has been seen that laser peripheral iridotomy preventing the conversion of PDS to ocular hypertension or pigmentary glaucoma. So this is the one study taken place at Italy, University Hospital of Parma, by Gandolfi, which is 10-year-old follow-up to see the effect of YAG peripheral laser iridotomy in pigment dispersion syndromes. So to divide the patients of high risk and low risk, they have done the provocative test with phenylephrine. So almost half of the patients showed high risk, which are elevated pressures or pigment release, and half of the patients showed low risk. And finally, in results, they have shown that more than up to 50 to 60% of the patients need peripheral iridotomy and there is reduction in the conversion of progression. So mainly laser peripheral iridotomy showed that almost reduced one third of the patients of the population of high risk they have noted. And other thing, apart from diagnosing the high risk patient, the laser peripheral iridotomy performed patient showed of same level of IOP with low risk eyes. Means the low risk and high risk patients who performed laser peripheral iridotomy are got equal. So laser peripheral iridotomy showed some low risk patients equal IOP. Coming to surgical management, this is the most commonly and effectively we can see that incisional surgeries get treated with trabeculectomy of pigmentary glaucomas. Basically, these patients are young, so having high healing properties, so we have to use adjunctives as mitomycin C and 5-fluorouracil. And these patients are again myopic, so always keep in mind that if you put higher concentration or more duration of mitomycin C or 5-fluorouracil, there is high risk of hypotonic maculopathy or thin cystic bleb formation. Then apart from incisional surgeries, you can go for minimally invasive glaucoma surgeries in pigmentary glaucoma, mainly trabectome as ab interno trabeculectomy and first generation micro bypass stent as eye stent or second generation as glaucoma. But compared to incisional surgeries, these stents have got low success rate longer follow-ups also. So incisional surgery is mainly proposed for pigmentary glaucomas to reduce the progression in glaucomatous optic neuropathy or glaucomatous visual field damage. Thank you. Any questions? Thank you. There are no questions at present.
Extensive class, sir. Thanks for doing that.